So, everybody, again, my name is Sarah George Waterfield. I am in the Department of English and Comparative Literature. And today I really want to take you through kind of the genesis of my project and where we are now. And as you can tell from my title, I am interested in texts and textiles. And there is a long-standing tradition of thinking about cloth and the page together. And so if you were looking at these two words, text and textile, maybe more ways of it, there might be some sort of connection there. You are not wrong. They share an etymological root in the Latin word texere, which means, quite evocatively, I think, to weave. And so, rather than sort of run through that whole history, which I'm not really qualified to do anyway, I want to give you a few phrases in English to think about. Spinning a yarn, weaving a tale, fabric of our lives, the warp and weft of life, threads of memory, lose the thread, tease out, embroider a story. Okay, so some of these are a little more common than others, but I would guess that you have all seen these threaded through your day-to-day existence. You might even say that they are well-worn. And in fact, we have textile-based metaphors shot through. That's a deep cut for any deep counting. Really all kinds of aspects of our daily life. And the fact that they are so well woven into our cultural consciousness is something that we don't really recognize until we start looking for them. And then you start looking for them and you can't stop looking for them, which is really quite annoying. But these specific metaphors are really at the genesis of my project. They all have to do with fabric, they all have to do with storytelling, they all have to do with memory. So you can see how things are starting to get sewn together. I will stop, I promise, for a while. So here's the thing though. Clothing, fabric, textiles, these are all like actual things in the world, right? Books are as well, I suppose, but the idea of a narrative is a little bit more ephemeral than the fact that we're all wearing shirts right now. And those shirts were made by people in the world with bodies that interacted with the fabric, with the needles, with the machines, with the space and environment of the factory or the workshop or the sewing room. They performed repetitive motions day after day after day. And that sort of specifically bodily labor is something that is really not captured in these metaphors. And so that labor then is also kind of frequently written out of our cultural storytelling. And there are a lot of reasons for that. I mean, this is labor that is frequently performed by women, whether in the factory or at home. It is labor that is frequently performed by either people outside of the borders of the United States as textile production moves back towards a global south. It is performed by people within the United States who are socially and economically marginalized, frequently immigrants, right? And in addition, it is also a sort of process and performance that is difficult to capture in writing. Not least because it is physical, it is bodily, it is sort of couched in muscle memory. And so the upshot of all of that is that the stories of the bodily work of textile labor and the people who do that are really written out of the archive. But there are people who are writing about it, people who are themselves frequently women, frequently marginalized, frequently silenced, and and they are doing it in ways that really lift up this textile work, be it sewing, weaving, mending, dyeing, spinning, embroidering, laundering, ironing, whatever, as viable alternative methods for knowledge production. And so in taking up the pen and writing these, following the threads, and writing these narratives of women who are intimately involved in textile work, these authors are not devaluing writing as a path to memory and storytelling and writing and knowledge production, but are suggesting that there are legitimate alternative ways of passing on a legacy. And so I want to go to a sort of 50-foot view, not a 1,000-foot view just yet, a 50-foot view of what my project is. And it examines three contemporary novels by US-based women of various different races and ethnicities. And I tried to choose works that run the gamut of not only the different type of textile work that you might encounter in these narratives, but also what that textile work, means for individuals, families, and communities. So Jean Plock's novel, Girl in Translation, follows a young girl and her widowed mother who are recent immigrants to the United States from Hong Kong, and they are sort of forced into sweatshop labor. The textile work of this novel is oppressive. It is composed of forced labor, of criminal working conditions, of really physical danger as well, although it does admit room for the creation of a family and community on the sweatshop floor as well. Daisy Hernandez's memoir, A Cup of Water Under My Bed, also features a mother who works in a garment factory as a recent US immigrant, although this work becomes more self-directed as she is finally able to open a tailoring and alteration business in her own home. We're going to come back to that area in a second, so put a pin in that. And Intizaki Shange's novel, Sassafras, Cypress, and Indigo, is perhaps the most positive and generative representation of textile work that I deal with, although it is not unproblematic in that way. It follows a family of women who spin, dye, and weave for their own pleasure, even as just a few generations before, they would have been doing so as slaves. So there is a broad swath of sort of the type of textile work and the type of knowledge it produces in these types of works. And in each case, it is linked to and complicates that sort of process of writing. And in being linked to writing, it brings up a whole host of other binaries that are kind of floating around in the ether that these women are dealing with or approaching or not or whatever. So we might think about the divide between thinking and making, writing and speaking, male, female, body, mind, citizen, immigrant, art, craft, serious, frivolous, whatever, and you can tell kind of in all of those binaries, which is the traditionally privileged term. So I want to take one brief example from A Cup of Water Under My Bed. This is a memoir that is told in a series of vignettes, and this passage comes from the very beginning of the final vignette. So it's two paragraphs, bear with me, I know you're not supposed to read, but you know, this is what I do. Okay, so when my mother needs to tailor a skirt to let out the waist or take it in, she turns the skirt inside out and lays it on the ironing board. She examines the seams, the places where the hilo is holding everything together, giving it shape, form, purpose. She adjusts her eyeglasses, makes her decisions, and picks up the scissors, the tiny ones that fit in the palm of her hand. The tips of the blades poke out like extra dedos, so that for a moment, my mother looks like a woman with seven fingers, two of them silver. Her hands are swift, almost brutal. She slips the silver dedos under the thread and yanks it from its place in the fabric. In English, we would say she's removing the stitching. In Spanish, however, the word is desparatar. If you ask my mother what she's doing with the skirt, she will keep her eyes on the hilo and say desparatándola. Not a taking away, but a taking apart. It is what I am doing here right now, what I have been doing in all the pages before. I have a story, I'm turning it inside out, laying it down on the ironing board, taking it apart with silver dados, desparatándola, so I can put it back together again the way I want, the way that makes sense now. So here we have a parallel labor between mothers and daughters. We have the collusion of text and textile, the specifically visceral language of tearing the skirt apart, the focus on translation, the collusion of the mother's body with the labor itself. itself, the suggestion of violence, and the possibility for reconstruction, recreation at the end. And so by observing her mother's work with fabric, with textiles, with clothing, Hernandez comes to a notably more physical understanding of what it is to work with memories, to tell stories. And so textile and text are really blending here. I've talked a little bit today about alternative modes of knowledge production and the process of legitimizing those modes, particularly through things like cloth, fabric, and textiles, or physical things in the world. So given that the novels with which I engage are so steeped in the material of the material world, I wanted my dissertation to follow suit. Therefore, in addition to, to more traditional academic articles and a blog detailing my process, the bulk of my dissertation is an art installation. And this is the link as well to my blog if you would like to follow along at that point. But this art installation really examines and interrogates the relationship between narrative, memory, and textile work through paper sculpture, garment creation, textile collage, blurring the distinction between text and textiles by weaving with paper-based yarn or salvaging the seams from discarded fast fashion. My hope is that this installation really reconfigures the narratives of these women who are living aslant of and needling a capitalist patriarchal system by reclaiming the labor of this quote-unquote women's work. So I use sort of austere paper and vibrant fabric to create what I hope are playful and playful and unexpected sort of exploration of the ways in which memory and narrative reside not only on the page, but in the warp and weft, in the feeling of fabric on the fingers, in the taste of string in the mouth. So I'd like to tie off loose ends today by inviting all of you to the very first iteration of this art installation, which is happening, and like really, this is like an actual invitation, please come. it's happening this Saturday from 5 to 9, anytime in there, go get some dinner, come on out, have a drink afterwards. I don't know if I'm allowed to say that right now. But it is happening at Fair Game Tasting Room in Pittsburgh, 5 to 9, and I hope that you all will join me and